Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My today's lecture is purely on the histopathological aspects of vesicobulous dermatosis. First of all, in the vesicobulous dermatosis, we will discuss the acantholytic disorders and other causes of intraepidermal blistering. Acantholysis is derived from a Greek word, acantha, which means prickle, and lysis means loosening. This is characterized by separation of keratinocytes at their desmosomal junctions. Since the desmosomes keep the polygonal shape of keratinocytes, when the desmosomal junctions break, the keratinocytes acquire circular shape. And these singly placed circular keratinocytes within the blister cavity are called as the acantholytic cells. There is a wide range of conditions that can have this feature. It could be because of a genetic mutations like in Darius disease or Hailey-Hailey disease, when there is mutation of ATP2A2 and ATP2C1 genes respectively. These genes encode for calcium pump, and a defect in the calcium pump result in desmosomal instability and causing acantholysis. Then acantholytic disorders also occur because of autoimmunity. For example, in pemphigus group of diseases, the antibodies are directly damage the desmosomes, causing acantholysis. Direct damage to desmosomes may occur as a secondary phenomena due to severe spongiosis that occur in eczema or intracellular balloon degeneration as we see in viral infections. So these are the acantholytic cells which are developed because of loss of desmosomal junctions. There is another term which should be introduced here, and this is apoptolysis. This is a recent term, and apoptolysis is proposed to explain acantholysis and keratinocyte damage which we see in pemphigus. It is suggested that there are a series of events that follow binding of autoantibodies to pemphigus antigens, resulting in initiation of cell death cascade, basal cell shrinkage, degradation of structural protein, and apoptosis of acantholytic cells. For a ready reference, this is a structure of desmosomes. Desmosomes are mainly comprising of a connection between the desmocolons and desmoglines. The yellow are desmoglines and purple are desmocolons. These desmogline and desmocolons are seen in the intercellular space, while the desmosome structure within the keratinocytes is formed by desmoplakins. The blue are desmoplakins. Placoglobins, the red one are placoglobin, and placophyllin, the green one are placophyllin. So this whole, which is comprising of the intracellular structure and intracellular structure comprises or make up the desmosomes. Pathogenesis of acantholysis and immunobulous disorders. Blistering develop as a consequence of autoantibodies directed against a variety of desmosomal protein. Desmogline 1 is the desmosomal protein in pemphigus foliaceus and pemphigus erythematosus, and desmogline 3, as well as which is seen in mucosa, and desmogline 1, which is seen in skin, are the two antigens which we see in pemphigus vulgaris, in pemphigus vegetans, in IgA pemphigus, and in drug-induced pemphigus. This is the clinical appearance of pemphigus vulgaris foliaceus. Pemphigus foliaceus is generally characterized by superficial erosions because the defect is subcorneal. So frank blistering is rarely seen. And this is seen mainly in the seborrheic areas. The pemphigus group of diseases does not have carry a significant inflammatory infiltrate within the blisters. And in this picture, we see a large subcorneal split with a few acantholytic cells in the blister cavity with no particular inflammatory infiltrate. Most of the epidermis is seen in the floor of the blister. This is an example of, again, a subcorneal blister containing numerous neutrophils. And among these neutrophils, you can see a number of acantholytic cells. So if the similar picture is seen without acantholytic cells, then we would call it a subcorneal pustular dermatosis. We always try to do immunofluorescence studies whenever we take biopsy for immunobullous or disorders. So if we take a perilesional biopsy in a patient of pemphigus foliaceus, then there will be a deposition of IgG, mainly IgG4 and C3, in between the dermo, between the keratinocytes at the between the keratinocytes, resulting in a fishnet appearance. But this fishnet appearance will be seen only at the top layer of epidermis. IgA pemphigus is a variant of pemphigus which is characterized by subcorneal vesicle that is filled with neutrophils. IgA pemphigus presents clinically as vesicles and pustules which are arranged in arcuate or annular configuration. And since these are subcorneal blisters, the vesicle and pustules are quite flaccid, rupture easily. So similarly, there is a subcorneal split filled with neutrophils and acantholytic cells. And the difference of immunofluorescence from the pemphigus foliaceus is that in case of IgA pemphigus, the antibodies which will be deposited at the desmosomal junctions will be IgA and not IgG. Subcorneal pustular dermatosis. You can see numerous pustules in succinate or serpiginous sheets. The clear clinical differential of subcorneal pustular dermatosis is IgA pemphigus and pustular psoriasis. So clinically, histologically, there will be large subcorneal pustules which appear to sit on a normal underlying epidermis. These are the subcorneal pustules. These are the subcorneal pustule in subcorneal pustular dermatosis. On the top, you can see a hyperkeratotic or normal stratum corneum, but here the neutrophils are seen in the parakeratotic column, and these are the Munro abscesses, and this should be differentiated from the subcorneal pustular dermatosis. Difference between subcorneal pustular dermatosis and IgA pemphigus. Mainly the histopathological difference is in the presence of acantholytic cells. And secondly, the positive direct immunofluorescence finding in IgA pemphigus, when the DIA findings will be negative in subcorneal pustular dermatosis. Then we are going to discuss the bacterial and viral infections. For example, bullous impetigo. Bullous impetigo is mainly a disease in children, which is characterized by small to large vesicles and blisters, which results in superficial erosions and crusting. Bullous impetigo is again a subcorneal split, and the split cleavage is seen immediately below the subcorneum and at the granular layer. Bacterial colonies will be seen within the split and variable amount of inflammatory infiltrate, which comprises of neutrophils. Occasional acantholytic cells are also seen, causing a little bit of confusion. And in case of doubt, you can go for direct immunofluorescence studies. Staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome is a dermatosis which is caused by the epidermolytic toxins of staphylococci when there is extensive desquamation of the skin, mainly seen in young children. So the split again occur at the level of granular layer. And there's marked acantholysis. So the child is toxic looking with this kind of histology. So we would be able to differentiate it with the normal pemphigus foliaceus, because pemphigus foliaceus would not occur in such a young child. So at the end, we would like to discuss the differential diagnosis of subcorneal pustules. So the first three are, we have already discussed, that is pemphigus foliaceus, IgA pemphigus, and subcorneal pustular dermatosis. Next two are pustular psoriasis and Reiter syndrome. And then the last four are the bullous impetigo, staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome, pustular fungal infection, and pustular drug eruptions. Brazilian pemphigus foliaceus or endemic pemphigus. It's an endemic disease which is caused by biting of a black fly belonging to a family of called as simulite. The lesions show very severe scaling and blistering is not apparent. Histopathologically, Phocoselvum is identical to pemphigus foliaceus. The clinical picture is also similar to pemphigus foliaceus. Immunofluorescence features again are similar to pemphigus foliaceus, and indirect immunofluorescence findings are also similar to pemphigus foliaceus. Then pemphigus erythematosus. This is a combination of pemphigus foliaceus and systemic lupus erythematosus. You can see a characteristic malar rash along with superficial erosions and occasional blistering and the seborrheic distribution. Histopathological features of pemphigus erythematosus are identical to pemphigus foliaceus, that is a subcorneal blister with neutrophils and acantholytic cells. The direct immunofluorescence is different from pemphigus foliaceus. As like in SLE, in addition to IgG, there will be other antibodies that will be deposited between the keratinocytes. Pemphigus vulgaris. Pemphigus vulgaris is the commonest form of pemphigus which we encounter, and it is characterized by extensive blisters leading to erosions and mainly involving the trunk and back. And usually the oral cavity is also involved. The blistering is suprabasal. So there will be a little bit of epidermis on the roof of these blisters. So these are flaccid blisters, but blistering will be appreciated in patients of pemphigus vulgaris clinically. Histologically, the blister in pemphigus vulgaris is a suprabasal blister. That means the basal layer will be attached to the dermal papillae, and then rest will be a blister cavity. And in the blister cavity, we can see several acantholytic cells. This is a little early presentation of pemphigus vulgaris. The basal cells are seen attached as tombstones on the dermal papillae. Pemphigus vulgaris is characterized by involvement of hair follicular epithelium, if it happens to come in between within the pemphigus lesions. And this acantholysis, which is seen in hair follicle epithelium, helps differentiate pemphigus vulgaris from Hailey-Hailey disease when the histopathological findings are very similar between the two. So you can see here the acantholytic cell and a split within the follicular epithelium. The direct immunofluorescence findings in pemphigus vulgaris is similar to pemphigus foliaceus, that is a deposition of IgG and C3, but now the fishnet pattern involves the whole epidermis. In pemphigus foliaceus, it involves only the superficial portion of epidermis, but in pemphigus vulgaris, whole of the epidermis is characterized by this fishnet pattern, which is made mainly by the deposition of immunoglobulin G and complement C3. Pemphigus vegetans. Pemphigus vegetans is a variant of pemphigus vulgaris. It will be called as pemphigus vegetans if the lesions are seen only in the flexures, and it will be called as the vegetating lesions of pemphigus vulgaris if the other lesions of pemphigus vulgaris are also present. Pemphigus vegetans is characterized by hypertrophic flexural vegetations and numerous intact vesicles. The closest differential diagnosis of pemphigus vegetans would be Hailey-Hailey disease, and it would be hidradenitis. Pemphigus vegetans is characterized histologically by hyperplasia of the epidermis as the lesions are vegetating, and characterized by intense inflammatory cell infiltrate within the epidermis that comprises mainly of eosinophils, but sometimes neutrophils are also seen. Acantholytic cells are seen within these infiltrates. Then there is another variety of pemphigus, which is called as pemphigus herpetiformis. Clinically, this looks like dermatitis herpetiformis with itchy vesicles and pustules seen on the extensor surfaces. But the direct immunofluorescence show IgG deposition in intracellular pattern like we see in pemphigus vulgaris. On histopathology, eosinophils or both eosinophils and neutrophil spongiosis is seen. There are intraepidermal vesicles and pustules along with papillary tip microabscesses. That is a little mixture between the pemphigus vulgaris and dermatitis herpetiformis. But the DIA finding will be that of pemphigus, not that of dermatitis herpetiformis. Paraneoplastic pemphigus is a group of pemphigus which is involved with several solid tumors which results in the clinical picture that is a mixture between severe pemphigus vulgaris and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. And histopathological findings are also similar to the two diseases. Antibodies are directed not only to desmocline, but also to Plakin family. And DIF shows immunoglobulin G deposition intracellularly and granular deposition of complement along the basement membrane. So histopathological findings are a mixture between the finding of pemphigus vulgaris showing suprabasal blistering along with damage to basement membrane and subepidermal blistering, as we see in Stevens-Johnson or 10. Hailey-Hailey disease, as already told you, is a genetic blistering disorder. It is not an autoimmune blistering disorder, which is caused by a genetic damage to the calcium pump, resulting in break of desmosomes. Clinically, it is characterized by involvement of flexures when the skin shows is erythematous, eroded, and crusted. Histologically, acantholysis is not full blown. We call the acantholysis in Hailey-Hailey disease as partial acantholysis. There is a special feature that the acantholysis will be seen in throughout the biopsy section, and hair follicles will not be involved. This picture highlights the incomplete acantholysis. There is no well-formed blistering, but you can appreciate that keratinocytes are, the desmosomal junctions are broken, and keratinocytes are loosely placed within this cavity. And this incomplete acantholysis is also called as the dilapidated brick wall appearance, as we see in ruins, old ruins. So in contrast to Dariya disease, the dyskeratosis is minimal or absent. The only feature is incomplete acantholysis. Now the Dariya disease. Again, a genetic acantholytic disorder because of defect of calcium pump. Dariya disease is characterized typically by involvement of hair follicle, and there are greasy papules, greasy and dirty brown papules seen mainly in seborrheic areas, forehead, on chest, and on back. The lesions in Dariya disease are typically follicular. You can see a parakeratotic type of clump, but there will be no parakeratosis genuine, but there will be few cells which resemble the parakeratosis. These cells are called as the grains. Then there will be dyskeratosis in the epithelium and suprabasal split seen beneath the follicular plugging. This picture highlights the grains which are seen in the follicular, in the keratin plug. Then the dyskeratotic cells which have apoptotic nuclei and a halo. Then acantholytic cells are seen in the blister cavity, and there are suprabasal blister. These are the dyskeratotic cells, which are called as the chorions. And this picture highlights the flat oval cells with cigar-shaped nuclei, which are called as the grains, and the suprabasal split seen within the follicular epithelium. Grover's disease is mainly seen in white races and on chest and trunk, and there is a relation to sun exposure. Histologically, Grover's disease is mini pemphigus vulgaris, in which we see a focal vesicle or split and intraepidermal vesicles like acantholytic, and we see acantholytic cells, suprabasal blister, but all are limited to a focal area within the biopsy section, because clinically, the lesions are also in a form of small papules and vesicles. Intraepidermal blister. Blister seen purely within the epidermis with surrounding spongiosis is typical of acute eczema and viral infections. In viral infections, in addition to this blister, there will be typical keratinocyte giant cells and balloon degeneration of keratinocytes, that is loss of the keratinocytes, acantholytic cells, and giant cells. These are the giant cells which are derived from the keratinocytes. And you can see the viral inclusion bodies within these cells. These are the intranuclear inclusion bodies. These are the giant cells. Huh? Now we are going to discuss the subepidermal blistering disorders. A vesicle derived from a bladder or bully derived from bubble. Bubble is accumulation of fluid either within or below the epidermis. Subepidermal blister develop at the epidermal or mucosal basement membrane region. The group include inherited disorders, traumatic, iatrogenic, which all are cell poor, and acquired or autoimmune disorders, which are usually cell-rich subepidermal blisters. There are six general mechanisms of subepidermal blister formation. First are the inherited mutational defects of basement membrane proteins, which we see in epidermolysis bullosa, all the three varieties, that is simplex, junctional, and dystrophic. Then the autoimmune destruction of basement membrane protein, which we see in autoimmune blistering disorders like bullous pemphigoid and dermatitis herpetiformis. Subepidermal blister is also seen when the cellular immunity, heightening of cellular immunity, cytotoxin is strong, and that leads to damage to basement membrane zone, which we see in erythema multiforme, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and 10. Some metabolic disorders also cause damage to basement membrane, resulting in blistering. This is seen in porphyrias, especially PCT, amyloidosis, and diabetes mellitus. Subepidermal blister is seen due to profound subepidermal edema, for example, in bullous insect bite reaction, or acute inflammatory process, for example, in Sweet syndrome. The dermoepidermal junction can be subdivided into three supramolecular networks. The first is the hemidesmosome and anchoring filament complex. This is the part of the basal cells of epidermis. Then the basement membrane itself. Then the last are the anchoring fibrils, which attach the basement membrane to the underlying dermis. So this is the basement membrane itself, and with the basal keratinocytes. This is how it would look like. These are the desmosomal connection between the keratinocytes, and these are the hemidesmosomes, which attaches the basal cells to the basement membrane. And basement membrane mainly comprises of a lighter zone, which is called as lamina lucida, and dense zone, which is called as lamina densa. Beneath the lamina densa, there is a fibroreticular lamina or fibronectin. From the lamina densa and fibronectin, the collagen bundles enter into the dermis. These are actually the anchoring proteins and are called as anchoring fibrils, comprising mainly of type 7 collagen. Another view of the different basement membrane proteins. This is the hemidesmosome, and hemidesmosomes comprises of plectin, bullous pemphigoid 230 antigen. Then keratin 5 and 14 are mainly the keratinocytes, are mainly the proteins seen within the keratinocytes. Then there is protein which originates from the hemidesmosomes and enter into the lamina lucida and lamina densa. This protein complex comprises of bullous pemphigoid 180 antigen and alpha 6, beta 4 integrin and laminin 5. Laminin 5 is the main component of lamina lucida. And from the lamina densa, these anchoring fibrils originates and are attached to the anchoring plaques. Anchoring fibrils and anchoring plaques are comprising of type 7 collagen. Keratin intermediate filaments insert into the plaque protein consisted of bullous pemphigoid antigen 230. So I have discussed all this. The lamina lucida is the weakest zone of dermoepidermal junction. It separates easily with heat, with suction, and on incubation with salt solution, as we see in several autoimmune diseases. Type 4 collagen is the main component of lamina densa. And anchoring fibrils originate at the lamina densa and extend into dermis and comprising of type 7 collagen. So type 4 collagen in lamina densa and type 7 collagen in anchoring fibrils. Use of immunohistochemistry in determining the site of split. This is seen mainly in genetic blistering disorders like epidermolysis bullosa. We use three antigens to determine the site of split: keratin 514, laminin 5, and type 7, type 4 collagen. In EB simplex, if we do immunohistochemistry on these three antigens and on a blister, then all the three antigens will be seen in the floor of the blister cavity. In EB junctionalis, like bullous pemphigoid, keratin 5 and 14, which we see within the keratinocyte, is present in the roof of the blister, while the laminin 5 and type 4 collagen will be seen in the floor. That means that in junctional EB, the split is at the level of lamina lucida. Then EB dystrophica, where the split is subepidermal, all the three antigens are seen at the roof of the blister. So this is EB simplex, where type 4 collagen is seen in the floor of the blister. Type 4 collagen is also seen in floor of the blister in junctional EB. In EB dystrophica, type 4 collagen is seen in the roof of the blister. So if the type 4 collagen is seen in the floor, it can be either EB simplex or EB junctionalis. But if it is seen in the roof of the blister, then it is EB dystrophica. Cell poor subepidermal blisters. So if we see a cell, a well-formed subepidermal blister with no particular inflammatory infiltrate, our differential diagnosis will be restricted to epidermolysis bullosa if it is a child, and epidermolysis bullosa acquisita if it's a adult, porphyria cutanea tarda, bullous amyloidosis, diabetic bulla, burn, cryotherapy, or suction blister. A cell-rich subepidermal blister will include the differential diagnosis of bullous pemphigoid, epidermolysis bullosa acquisita, which can present both as cell-poor and cell-rich subepidermal blister, bullous SLE, dermatitis herpetiformis, and linear IgA disease. Now discussing the pemphigoid group of diseases first. Usually the pemphigoid starts as a prodromal stage, in which the patient mainly present as itchy and urticarial lesions without any blistering. If we take a biopsy at this time, then the biopsy will be like a biopsy of some allergic dermatitis comprising of perivascular eosinophilic infiltrate along with eosinophilic exocytosis and little bit of a spongiosis. So dermal edema with numerous perivascular eosinophils. As the patient of pemphigoid progresses, first we see small vesicles and then we see large blisters. If we take a biopsy of a vesicle, which is also called as a vesicular pemphigoid, then there will be small subepidermal blisters or vesicles, which comprise mainly of eosinophils at the dermal papillae. Now, this is the frank bullous pemphigoid. We see large, tense blisters. The blisters are tense because most of the epidermis is seen at the roof of the blister. So the blisters are relatively tense, not easily ruptured. Erosions are seen, but not as much as we see in pemphigus vulgaris. Histologically, there will be large subepidermal split, and the blister cavity contains numerous eosinophils. Dermal papillae are seen protruding within the blister cavity. Eosinophils are also seen within the dermis around the blood vessels. This is a large subepidermal blister, which is dome-shaped, unilocular, containing edema fluid, fibrin, and inflammatory infiltrate, which is mainly comprising of eosinophils. DIF from a perilesional skin in patient of bullous pemphigoid will show a linear basement membrane zone staining of immunoglobulin G and complement C3. If we see this immunofluorescence ultrastructurally, then this linear band is giving an encirclated pattern. These are the immunoglobulin which are deposited on the basement membrane in encirclated, that is making an N letter look appearance. This encirclated pattern is seen in mainly bullous pemphigoid and related disorders. Regarding bullous pemphigoid, DIF show linear IgG and C3. Indirect immunofluorescence highlights IgG in 75 to 80% of the cases. If we do a salt split, then the immunoglobulins are seen at the roof of the blister and type 4 collagen ends in the floor. Site of split is mainly lamina lucida. Antigens in bullous pemphigoid are 230 kilo Dalton antigen, which is a part of hemidesmosome, and 180, which is also called as bullous pemphigoid antigen 1. Well, bullous pemphigoid 180 kilo Dalton antigen, also called as bullous pemphigoid antigen 2, is part of the basement membrane. Pemphigoid gestationis is a form of bullous pemphigoid which we see in pregnant women. These lesions are intensely itchy and urticarial, papules, plaques, and vesicles and blisters in an annular configuration and mainly seen peri-umbilicus and clustering in the abdomen. Histology is quite similar to bullous pemphigoid with subepidermal blistering and intense eosinophilic infiltrate, both within the blister cavity and in the dermis. Direct immunofluorescence finding is a little different from bullous pemphigoid, although we see both immunoglobulin G and C3. But in case of pemphigoid gestationis, C3 is seen in almost 100% of DIF findings. C3 is a 100% of is seen in 100% of cases, and IgG is seen in 30 to 50% of cases. In case of bullous pemphigoid, complement is seen in 30 to 50% of the cases, and IgG is seen in 100% of patients of bullous pemphigoid. So this is a little difference between the immunofluorescence of pemphigoid gestationis with bullous pemphigoid. Lichen planus pemphigoides is a type of lichen planus in which we see the lichenoid papules, typically lichenoid papules, along with the blisters of bullous pemphigoid. So these are the two clinical disorders in combination. So blisters may not be seen over the lesions of lichen planus. If the blisters are seen on the lesions of lichen planus, it will be called as the bullous lichen planus and not lichen planus pemphigoides. Histologically, the lichen planus pemphigoides is characterized by the typical histology of the two diseases in combination. That is, at places we will see interface change and band-like lymphohistocytic infiltrate, and at other places we will be seeing a subepidermal blistering with eosinophils. Secretricial pemphigoid is a variety of pemphigoid that involves the mucous membranes and resulting in scarring. Reason for scarring in secretricial pemphigoid is the presence of antibodies to laminin 5 and type 7 collagen. These antibodies are not seen in bullous pemphigoid, where the antibodies are mainly directed against bullous pemphigoid antigen 230 and 180. But in secretricial pemphigoid, the antibodies are also directed against laminin 5 and type 7 collagen. And there is a detection of C3 and C4 in lamina densa as well. Another diagnostic pointer of secretricial pemphigoid is presence of immunoglobulin A along with immunoglobulin G in DIF of secretorial pemphigoid. Secretorial pemphigoid, if we take a blister, then the then histologically its appearance is very similar to bullous pemphigoid. That is a large subepidermal blister rich in eosinophils. Epidermolysis bullosa acquisita is characterized by small vesicles with erosions and crusting, mainly seen in areas which are prone to trauma, like knuckles, like elbows, knees, ankles. And clinically, it resembles porphyria cutanea tarda, except that the changes of chronic photodermatitis are not seen in EBA. Sometimes EBA also mimics dermatitis herpetiformis if the lesions are seen on the extensor aspects of the knee and elbow. EBA is a characteristic bullous dermatosis in which you can find all kind of histological appearances, starting from a cell poor subepidermal blister with no particular inflammatory infiltrate and only fibrin, to a subepidermal blister containing lots of eosinophils mimicking bullous pemphigoid, or a subepidermal blister containing lots of neutrophils looking like linear IgA disease. So EBA is a histological mimicker of both bullous pemphigoid and linear IgA disease. Regarding EBA, the direct immunofluorescence will demonstrate linear IgG and complement as we see in bullous pemphigoid. So many a times, such patients will be labeled as bullous pemphigoid because of the subepidermal blister containing eosinophils and linear deposition of IgG at the basement membrane zone, but will be different from bullous pemphigoid clinically, that the blistering will not be seen in the flexures and abdomen. Rather, it will be seen at the trauma-prone areas, and it will be very poor to respond to systemic corticosteroids. Indirect immunofluorescence will show immunoglobulin G, but only in 25 to 50% of cases. We will be discussing the salt split in EBA, and site of split is sublamina densa in EBA, and antigens are mainly type 7 collagen. That's why the deposition is deep. The salt split immunofluorescence is a procedure which we use when there is a doubt between bullous pemphigoid and EBA, both clinically and on histopathology. So what we do first is to take the perilesional skin biopsy and immerse it in 1 molar sodium chloride solution for 48 hours at 4 degrees centigrade. After this incubation, artificial blister is created at the lamina lucida. So the lamina densa is at the floor of the blister, and rest of the epidermis is at the roof of the blister. Now, after having this blister, creating this artificial blister, we do the direct immunofluorescence. And let's suppose this is a patient of bullous pemphigoid. So in the bullous pemphigoid, the main antigens are bullous pemphigoid antigen 230 and 180. Both are present at the roof of the blister. And if it is a patient of EBA, the EBA antigen is type 7 collagen, so it will be present in sublamina densa. So if we do a DIF on a salt split, this is an intact epidermis, this is a salt split. In EBA, the immunofluorescence will be seen at the floor of the blister. And in case of bullous pemphigoid, the immunofluorescence will be seen at the roof of the blister. Bullous systemic lupus erythematosus. Bullous SLE is a variety of systemic lupus erythematosus in which, in addition to the typical findings of SLE, malar rash and other ulcerated lesions, lupus hairs, etc., we see blistering both on sun and non-sun exposed areas. The patient must fulfill other criteria of diagnosis of SLE. The blistering is subepidermal, so there will be dense blisters with surrounding erythema. Histologically, there will be a subepidermal blistering, which will be rich in neutrophils. In addition to this finding, the other typical finding of SLE, that is perivascular, moderately dense perivascular lymphohistiocytic infiltrate in the dermis will also be seen. Such a rich infiltrate will not be seen in any other autoimmune blistering disorder. So the presence of neutrophils within this blister of bullous SLE makes it difficult to diagnose histologically with linear IgA or DH. But definitely clinically, the patient will be a known patient of SLE, or if it's not a known patient, then he or she will be fulfilling the other criteria of systemic lupus erythematosus. So otherwise, histologically, the blister of bullous SLE will be similar to linear IgA disease, that is a subepidermal blister with abundant neutrophils. If we go for a direct immunofluorescence findings, then in addition to IgG, IgA, and IgM is seen deposited in a granular or linear fashion at the basement membrane zone. So DIF show deposition of IgG, complement IgM and IgA. Indirect immunofluorescence IgG are in good quantity. In salt split, the immunofluorescence will be seen in the floor because like EBA, the antigen in bullous SLE is type 7 collagen. Then dermatitis herpetiformis. DH has a very characteristic appearance. It comes in the differential diagnosis of extremely itchy or pruritic dermatosis and characterized by numerous papillovesicles, mainly on the extensor surfaces, on the knee, back, buttocks, ankle, elbows, and sometime on shoulders as well. Histologically, there will not be big blisters, but rather there will be small papillary tip abscesses because clinically, it is also characterized by vesicles and pustules and not characterized by large blisters. So histologically, there will not be large blisters, but there will be small abscesses or neutrophilic infiltrate at the tip of dermal papillae. You can see these are the dermal papillae and a small split on the top of dermal papillae. We call it as papillary tip microabscesses. You can see this is the dermis, this is the epidermis, and this is a small sort of vesicle which is restricted to one of the retiridges, area between the two retiridges. Similarly, this is again a papillary tip microabscess. The direct immunofluorescence finding of dermatitis herpetiformis from perilesional skin will show the granular deposition of IgA at the tips of dermal papillae. Fibrin is also deposited. So there is granular IgA deposition. Indirect immunofluorescence will show anti-transglutaminase antibodies. And salt spread will not demonstrate any finding. and antigens in DH are, however, unknown. Then adult linear IgA disease. It is again a highly pruritic disorder, which is characterized by blistering, and the blisters are arranged in annular configuration. This kind of blistering is the in annular configuration is seen in pemphigoid gestationis in linear and IgA pemphigus. Two also. So IgA also present in childhood, where it is also called SCBDC or childhood linear IgA disease. The characteristic finding of blistering in annular configuration is seen in linear IgA disease as well. This is giving an appearance of string of pearl. Blisters in IgA are large blisters, clinically as well as histologically. So there will be large subepidermal blisters which are rich in neutrophils. It is not like DH where there are small vesicles, mainly on the dermal papillae, but here there are large blisters with rich neutrophilic infiltrate. And if we do the immunofluorescence will demonstrate linear deposition of IgA at the dermoepidermal junction. If we see it ultrastructurally, then this deposition will be in form of letter U. So it is called as U serrated pattern, which differentiates it from the N serrated pattern of bullous pemphigoid. But the N serrated pattern of bullous pemphigoid is made by deposition of immunoglobulin G, while the U serrated pattern in case of linear IgA disease is made by IgA. So IgA shows a linear IgA deposition. In indirect immunofluorescence, only 30% of IgA will be circulating within the blood. And antigens are different antigens in IgA, that is, which includes bullous pemphigoid antigen 180 and 230. In addition to that, there will be 200, 250, 285, and 290 kilodalton antigens in the basement membrane. So this is a comparison between a subepidermal blister that is rich in neutrophils and subepidermal blister that is rich in eosinophils. So subepidermal blister rich in neutrophils, there will be dermatitis herpetiformis and linear IgA. The difference is in linear IgA, there will be small vesicles, papillative microabscesses, while in linear IgA, there will be large blisters. Vesicular pemphigoid. Vesicular pemphigoid is also characterized by small vesicles. Bullous SLE characterized by large blisters with neutrophils. Then inflammatory EB, A, epidermolysis bullosa acquisita and Sui syndrome. Subepidermal blisters with eosinophils, bullous pemphigoid, prototype pemphigoid gestationis. We can see it in Wells syndrome, in arthropod bites, in severe bullous insect bites and in drug reactions. We can see the subepidermal blistering with mainly in lymphocytes. This is seen in all the regions in which there is damage to basement membrane by cellular immunity, whereas we see in erythema multiforme, Stevens-Johnson N10, in paraneoplastic pemphigus, in bullous fixed drug eruption, in ligand planus pemphigoides and polymorphic light eruption. There is a very rare type of subepidermal blistering with mast cells, which we see in urticaria pigmentosa. Now a few tips of taking biopsy in a blistering disorder. An incisional skin biopsy should be taken from a fresh blister. Along with that, a perilesional skin biopsy that should be not more than 1 centimeter away from the fresh blister. The transport medium for the histopathological biopsy for histopathology will be 10% formalin solution, freshly made, while normal saline will be used as a transport medium for the perilesional skin to the laboratory where immunofluorescence testing is available. The sample should reach the laboratory within 2 to 6 hours. If more time is taken, then the biopsy in normal saline will be denatured. However, the biopsy in formalin will be preserved for at least 3 more days. Mitchell's medium is used for a longer transport of biopsy for DIF, but Mitchell's medium is not readily available in our country. This diagram shows the way to perform the direct immunofluorescence, although I have posted my presentation on how to perform DIF and indirect immunofluorescence. But generally, the antigen is already attached. We take a perilesional biopsy, so the antigen is already attached to the place where it should be. And we incubate the perilesional biopsy with different kind of antibody tagged immunofluorescence. So this is an antibody which is tagged with immunofluorescence. So the antibodies which are of different type that include IgA, IgG, IgM, and complement. So if we take a biopsy of pemphigus vulgaris, then the antibodies which will be attached to the antibodies which are already present in the perilesional skin, which will be anti-globulin antibodies which are tagged with fluorescence. So we can we will be incubating these anti-globulin antibodies, and then after incubation, all the 3 or 4 slides will be washed off, and we look for the anti-globulin tagged immuno antibodies in the fluorescent microscope. If it is pemphigus, then IgG will be seen deposited on the in the fishnet pattern. If it is pemphigus, the bullous pemphigoid, then IgG will be seen deposited at the basement membrane. And if it is linear IgA disease, then IgA will be seen deposited in the basement membrane. In indirect immunofluorescence, the same process is done, but this time the biopsy, this time we don't take a perilesional biopsy, but rather we take serum from the patient and we use the circulating antibodies to attached to the specific antigen sites in a skin sample, which is taken from the rat or mouse. And once, first of all, we let these circulating antibodies attach to the specific antigen sites. Then after this process, we repeat the same process which we do in DIF, and we add anti-globulin fluorescent tagged antibodies and wash it and see which of the fluorescent tagged antibodies attached to the antibodies in the indirect immunofluorescence sample. So for further detail and for further clarification, please see my video on these two subjects. I thank you all for a very patient listening, and have a very good day.